Thank you, everyone, for leaving the chamber quietly. And the next item of business is members' business debate on motion 4016 in the name of Graeme Dey on included in the main. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. May I ask those who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now, and may I remind those leaving the chamber from the public galleries to do so quietly, please. I call on Graeme Dey to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Dey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by acknowledging the cross-party support the motion we're debating has attracted and my gratitude for that. The first 7 signatures it secured was sufficient to ensure every party represented in this Parliament had backed it. That's clearly indicative of the fact the subject matter transcends party political allegiances, and I hope the tone and nature of the debate tonight reflects that also. The issues covered in the Enable report, included in the main, are way too important to be the subject of point scoring around service provision and the funding of such. It's now some 17 years since the presumption to mainstream was enshrined in the Standards in Scotland Schools Act, and that piece of legislation was followed in 2004 by the Education Additional Support for Learning Scotland Act, in which it is stated, every education authority must, in relation to each child and young person having additional support needs, make adequate and efficient provision for such additional support as is required by that child or young person. Tonight, we consider Enable Scotland's report included in the main, which makes 22 recommendations to complete the journey to true inclusion, arguing that we're not there yet in terms of catering not just for educational but emotional needs and ensuring there is sufficient support in place to ensure participation in all parts of school life. And we do so against a backdrop of the Scottish Government reviewing the guidance around the presumption in favour of mainstreaming and having a ministerial team with a genuine understanding of the subject and a commitment to getting it right for every child. Every child. Time constraints will prevent me from exploring the specifics of the recommendations. I hope colleagues taking part tonight may between them be able to at least touch on some of these. Included in the main draws on the full gamut of experience, it canvassed the views of children and young people, parents and carers, and the education workforce. And tellingly, 80% of that last category indicated we are not taking account of getting it right for every child through the presumption that all could and should be taught in mainstream settings. That's we as a society, not national government or local government, but as a society. Presiding Officer, I would contend that it's not so much the principle of mainstreaming, but the way in which it's being interpreted and implemented, which is at the root of the problem. There will always be a role for very specialist schools catering for kids with the most complex of needs, but we can cater for the majority of ASN children in mainstream, if they will, and yes, sufficient resources there. This is not an easy subject. There are some difficult aspects to it. One such aspect is the reality that medical advances mean we have children with very complex needs being catered for in mainstream school settings now, with all the impact that has on resources and indeed the support being afforded other ASN youngsters. Another is the spike, the massive spike, a good thing on one level, in kids being identified as having additional support needs, again with the accompanying resource issue that brings. I should acknowledge that I come to this subject as the husband of an ASN assistant. But more than anything, my interest is driven by the experience of a constituency MSP dealing with casework. We've come a long way since 2000, there is no doubt about that. But on the ground, there is a lack of consistency in approach and resourcing. In relation to the former, I was speaking recently to a head teacher who had decided to externally review the ASN provision within his school, which has a good reputation in this regard. His school sits in a local authority which has no special school available to cater for children with very complex needs. It buys in a small number of places annually from a facility in a neighbouring council area. One of the reviewers headed up a special needs school elsewhere in Scotland. He was taken aback to discover she had at her disposal 14 teaching and 51 support staff to cater for a roll of 56. It was a resourcing level way, way beyond what he had at his disposal, and this was one of 3 such schools in that local authority. Presiding Officer, personally, I think there has to be a place for such specialist schools to cater for kids with the most complex needs, not least of all because it frees up resource to support those bairns who right now are falling through the cracks, youngsters whose attainment levels and sense of self-worth could, with just a little help and support, be raised. We tend, when we're talking about closing the attainment gap, to link the problem to poverty. But as this report states, the attainment gap does not start and end on that point. Young folk with learning disabilities experience many other barriers to achieving their potential. Albeit in a different context, the First Minister acknowledged this last week in announcing a £2 million fund to improve access to nursery for children with ASN. I wonder whether, in closing, the Minister could outline whether and to what extent the guidance offered to head teachers around deploying the additional funding given them directly to tackle the attainment challenges references ASN pupils. Of all the experience I've had as an MSP these past 6 years, there's one more than any other that stuck with me. A couple of years back, I met a young lad, a young carer, whose brother suffers from a rare disease. I could only begin to imagine what life at home must be like for him as a younger sibling demanded the attention, not just of the parents, but him himself. Then he explained to me how he suffered from dyslexia and was struggling to achieve his potential at school because the support that was meant to be in place for him wasn't being provided. He was meant to have time in the learning support base for one-to-one support to cope with schoolwork. But he told me, there's a girl in the base who behaves really badly and the staff are always dealing with her, so I don't get the help I need. There he was, his home life as it was, and being let down in the educational setting, and him so readily recognising the detrimental impact the lack of support at school was having. Much more recently, just a few weeks ago, in fact, I met a mum whose teenage daughter, who has complex needs, has been unable to attend a local secondary school base for some months. Ahead of an effort to try and reintegrate her, the mum was invited to visit the newly refurbished base facilities, which she'd been told would be an asset in catering for the girl, who is, amongst other things, autistic. But in terms of decor, the colour scheme was not autism-friendly, the sensory room was tiny, and the soundproofing so inadequate that sitting in it, you could hear the kids passing in the adjoining corridor. Presiding officer, simple, basic things. And that parent's experience, so typical of that identified in the report of parents and carers, when asked to describe their experience of the school system, 67% used the word battle, 77% stressful, 44% alone. When asked if the support provided was enough to secure their participation in all aspects of school life, less than 12% felt it did. And even allowing for the fact that a proportion of parents, let's face it, do have unreasonable expectations of what could be available, should be available, that's still a concerning number. Of course, we're not just talking about strictly educational matters here. This is also about mental well-being. 60% of the kids with learning difficulties who were interviewed said they felt lonely at school. Presiding officer, can I, having already declared an interest, give a shout out to those hard-pressed ASN staff in our mainstream schools who are having to contend with increasing demands, not just numerically, but in terms of the range of conditions, catering for children and young people with incredibly complex needs through to those bairns, like the young lad I mentioned earlier, who just need that little bit of support. They do a remarkable job, and we should take this opportunity to acknowledge that. Time and again, I hear parents of ASN children drawing a distinction between criticising the support for their kids and those who seek to provide it. Presiding officer, to conclude and allow colleagues to contribute to this debate, included in the main sums the situation up rather well when it says in the report, the policy of mainstreaming has undoubtedly been a positive step towards equality and creating a more inclusive society, but now we need to ensure that the policy is supporting children with learning disabilities to be properly supported and fully included at their school, because only then will our societal aspiration for full inclusion be realised. Presiding officer.
Can we have speeches of around 4 minutes, please? And I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I just begin by saying it's a pleasure talking a debate like this, where I think we can agree in terms of the broad thrust of what we need to achieve and why we need to achieve it. Indeed, I think discussing additional support needs, I think, exemplifies some of the real strengths that we have in Scotland. We have a very broad definition of additional support needs. That creates a challenge, but I think it also represents the way that we try to approach education in a holistic, child-centred way, one that seeks to include, one that seeks to actually focus on what every child needs to learn. Indeed, at a recent visit I made to one of my local primary schools, I think that it really brought out how that approach can really be brought to life and how it can be made to work. As I was being led through the Victorian primary school, I got led past a stairwell, and there was a fantastic canopy there, a big dark black bit of cloth with things dangling down beneath. and there was a wee boy in there, and that was the space he liked to go to. Because of his particular needs and requirements, he needed that quiet space, that special space where it was just him, and then he could just settle his thoughts and get his head together for learning. And there was a classroom assistant with him, helping him with what he needed to do. And I also learned from the head teacher there about the training they put in place at that school, both from the local authority but also externally sourced, and the groups of teachers that work to actually talk about additional support needs. And I think that brought to life how it's meant to work, how it can work when it's done properly. So I thank Graeme Dey for bringing forward this motion. I think it's really important we talk about this thing. And I'd like to also thank Enable, because while I think it's good to talk about where it works, we also need to talk about where we need to get better, where we need to improve the situation and the resources available. And I think there's three key things. I think we need to talk about the support and training that teachers have available to them, both as they in their practice, but also in terms of what they receive through their teacher training before they qualify as teachers. We need to talk about the support staff that are required and the specialist staff, I think, in particular. And we also need to talk about how we embed ASN into the curriculum and the classroom experience more widely. And indeed, I think this dovetails very neatly and closely with some of the issues that we've been discussing in Education Committee. And we've been looking in particular at additional support needs, and we've had a recent roundtable. And I think there were some issues of concerns from the experts on additional support needs there, where they described access to training as being patchy. There was discussion that the training that was available to teachers was at times only available through cascade training, where one teacher had received training, then provided that training on to others. And that because of the many changes that we've had in curriculum, and also indeed in terms of qualifications, that there has been a squeezing out of some of these the training and support that's required in order to address additional support needs. And indeed, a very concerning observation that postgraduate training in terms of specialist additional support needs is something that had declined. And indeed, I think we see some of these borne out in the work that Enable has provided in their briefing, with 12% of teachers saying that their educational development needs that they need to provide, only 12% saying that they can provide those educational and development needs. Indeed, and also teacher stories of training and descriptions of not having the support they need to develop the PLPs that they need to do. But we also need to talk about support and special staff, and I think the Enable report makes it very clear. You know, while we have a massive increase in the number of children being identified as additional support needs, and I think that is something to be celebrated, we have a decline in specialist additional support needs teachers. We have an ageing population of those teachers which are left. And I think that is something that the government really does need to focus on and prioritise, because we need those specialist teachers. While classroom assistants are important in developing personalised learning, they're not a substitute for specialist additional support needs teachers. Now, I could carry on for a great deal longer, but I see the clock has clicked past 4 minutes, so I'll sit down and thank the member once again for bringing forward this debate.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. Can I have Jeremy Balfour, please, to be followed by David Torrance.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Mr Dey for his motion and for bringing the debate to us this afternoon? And can I also thank Enable for the report that they have written? With over 800 young people with learning disabilities interviewed, with parents, family carers, educationalists across Scotland, we have a very full picture of what is going on. And I think we should start by saying we have come a long way as a civic society in Scotland and as educationalists in Scotland over the last 30 or 40 years. Mainstreaming, by and large, is a positive thing and a good thing. The type of language we use now about people with special needs, or the type of language we use about the requirements they have definitely improved. But I think the report is also a wake-up call for us as well. But the reality is, for still many young people in Scotland today, they are not getting what they require. I remember, in regard to having my own physical disability, the comment that my mother made to somebody else who had a disability, and that was, never say no when you ask first time. And I feel that is still the case today, that parents have to keep asking, local authorities, head teachers for things that should also automatically come to them. And that's fine if you're articulate and pushy like my mother. It's maybe less so if you don't have those skills. I want to just briefly comment on two things which I still think we need to move on, not in regard to just government, but as a parliament and as a country. And the first is to say that being in a classroom doesn't mean that you're part of a school. Just because you're there physically doesn't mean that you're part of the whole experience. The report makes clear that often children with additional needs can feel excluded and lonely and not get the same opportunities as their peers. No child should be excluded. The report tells us that 49% of young people with a learning disability or autism feel that they've not been able to reach their full potential at school. More than a quarter say they can't take part in games or sport. Nearly a quarter don't go on trips with their own peers. And nearly half, 46%, say they don't take part in the playground or in other activities. Now, I accept that that will vary from school to school and from area to area. But I think the challenge comes for all of us to reach that. I want to pay credit to the number of additional support needs teachers that we have, the hard work they do day in, day out. But I think there's a challenge here for our local authorities. But we have seen the number of auxiliaries and support staff dropping across Scotland. And I think it's unfair on a teacher to be looking after 30 or so children without that help if they have children with ASN within them. I think we also have to acknowledge that mainstreaming is not right for every child. Getting it right for every child means looking at every child and where they are at the time. And again, it slightly concerns me that over the last 7 years, the number of special schools has fallen. There's been a 25% drop in the number of special schools between 2008 and 2015. Now, yes, mainstreaming probably for the majority of children is the way forward, but not on every case. So I welcome Mr. Bates. I think there's a challenge for all of us across Scotland. We're making progress. We just need to keep moving in that direction. Thank you.
Can we have David Torrance to be followed by Mark Ruskell?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Graeme Dey for securing this debate in the Chamber today to welcome a campaign included in the main to bring awareness to and stimulate conversation about children and young people with learning disabilities. I'd also like to recognise Enable Scotland, a charitable organisation aimed at fighting discrimination and inequality against young people struggling with disabilities. The Scottish Government is committed to delivering excellence and quality in Scottish education, especially to many young people who have learning disabilities and are often unfairly excluded by friends, peers, classrooms and opportunities and experiences that make up such a big part of childhood and school life. The delivery plan for Scottish education is committed to closing the attainment gap, ensuring that we have a curriculum and empowering our teachers, schools and communities for children and young people. Children and young people's education experience should open the doors to opportunities which enable children to become successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens and effective contributors to society. This includes children and young people who struggle with disabilities. However, inclusive education is still far from reality for many young people and children who are struggling. Enable Scotland held a national conversation about the experience of young people with learning disabilities. Over 7 months, they received more than 800 responses from people across Scotland. 60% says they feel lonely at school. Only 49% felt that they are achieving their full potential. And 80% of educational workforce believe they were not getting it right for every child. As a result of these statistics, the Scottish Government and Enable Scotland now work even more closely to revisit some of the policies regarding inclusive education. Enable has come up with 22 detailed recommendations on how to improve the lives of children with learning disabilities. Included in the main, set out to listen, and now it is our turn to act. An initiative that welcomes inclusive education involves an array of complex partnerships and dialogues. Students, parents, carers and teachers are all involved in creating supportive networks. Because of a diverse set of actors involved, the solutions and tactics should reflect this diversity, creating support for individualised needs to facilitate equal opportunities to participate in society. The movement towards inclusion has spread to a large-scale government, such as the UN's Convention on the Rights of a Child, which abolished segregated education that denies children with disabilities the right to be part of mainstream schooling. Even though this international recognition is a significant move in the right direction, I believe that Scotland will benefit from the localised efforts to provide unique opportunities to place inclusive education firmly on the political agenda. Fife Council, for example, aims to support any need for additional support that children may have. Working closely with families, Fife's priority is for all children to attend their local school and to be successful there, rather than isolating children from their peers. Within my constituency of Kirkcaldy, the approach of a new Windmill Community Campus embodies this inclusion. Integrated into campus alongside V4 High School, council offices, community youth sports facilities and a public library is Rosalind School, a state-of-the-art facility which caters for children and young adults aged between 3 and 18 who have complex additional support needs. The importance of collaborative teaching strategies cannot be overstated, and in recognition of this, the school works closely with their mainstream colleagues, not only to ensure access and achievements for all, but to enhance opportunities for all pupils to develop their learning together. In addition, every school in Fife has a learning support teacher who advises classes and teachers how best to assist children and young people with additional support needs. The More Choices, the More Chances agenda aims to increase the number of young people above the age of 16 in education, employment or training by encouraging the value of formal learning to help develop social and employability skills. In addition, active school coordinators offer all children and young people opportunities and motivation to adapt active healthy lifestyles now into adulthood. Services like these are also extended to higher level of education, such as Fife's Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Team, who aim to develop skills, confidence, motivation, independence and expertise. Each campus provides one-to-one support. Inclusion continues to be an ongoing process, not a fixed state. All children, whoever learning is taking place, deserve to be educated together despite barriers and requirements for additional support. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I believe that our country values our diverse communities. It is important to promote inclusive learning and education because communities are formed at school where young people learn, play and grow together and learn to live alongside each other.
I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Johan Lamont.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to declare an interest as a councillor and also the father of a child with additional support needs. I'd also like to thank Graeme Dey for bringing forward this motion for debate here tonight, and also Enable Scotland, who do some fantastic work around Scotland. I was very privileged to attend one of the support focus groups in Stirling several months ago with young people, and I learned so much about the challenges and barriers that they face in their everyday lives. So thank you for that experience. I learned so much. Since the early 2000s, all Scottish schools have had a presumption to mainstream, and it is a key part of ensuring that education is inclusive, as a step towards ensuring that our society is inclusive for people with disabilities. And this law has changed in response to the demands and the campaigns led by people with disabilities. Their aim is to secure a more equal and inclusive society for us all. However, whilst the law has changed, it's clear that many other barriers remain. And while there is a presumption to mainstream, many schools do not have the resources that they need to meet additional needs, and teachers do not always have the access to adequate training on how to teach pupils with a wide spectrum of learning disabilities. Since 2010, the number of pupils identified with a learning disability has risen by over a quarter. Yet over the same period, the number of specialist teachers has declined by 1 in 7, and specialist assistants has declined by 1 in 11. We've estimated that it will cost just £31 million to return specialist teachers and support staff back to their 2010 levels. Now, councils have faced years of austerity, putting intense pressure on wider education budgets that have not been ring-fenced. And the Scottish Government's latest response, the Pupil Equity Fund, directs resources towards schools in areas of higher deprivation. And while this is much needed and much welcome, it doesn't adequately address learning disabilities and additional support needs. So while councils work their way through budget savings, it's hugely important that frontline services are protected. And that's why, as a group of Greens, we prioritised additional unring-fenced funding in the budget this year, specifically for councils to take the most damaging proposed cuts to education off the table. And while schools need the resources to hire more specialist teachers, we also need to ensure that all teachers have appropriate training on additional support needs. Enable Scotland found that 98% of the education workforce does not feel that teacher training adequately prepares them to teach pupils with learning disabilities. There's little wonder that so many pupils feel excluded. Initial teacher training already sees new teachers take on a huge workload. And often this is one-year PGDs crammed with university classes and placements. As Enable Scotland have highlighted, this often doesn't leave enough time for adequate training on additional support needs. It's often dependent on whether the teachers of handling the placement have actually experienced teaching pupils with learning disabilities themselves. In addition to this, Enable Scotland have highlighted that access to continuous career development can vary significantly from one local authority to another. In fact, the Education Committee heard just a few weeks ago that one teacher was told to watch The Big Bang Theory to learn about Asperger's syndrome. What we need is the mainstreaming of additional support needs in teacher training. All teachers need both the initial training and access to high-quality further training to ensure that we are meeting the educational needs of pupils with learning disabilities and other additional support needs. The Scottish Government needs to take clear action to ensure that our schools are inclusive. We're open to working with them to make inclusive education a reality.
I call Johan Lamont and then Alexander Burnett.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I say that I'm very happy to contribute in what I think is a very important debate, and can I congratulate Graeme Dey in securing this debate and affording the opportunity to explore some of these really important and challenging issues for families right across Scotland. I'd also want to congratulate Enable on the important work it does in supporting people with learning disabilities and recognise the work they have done over many years alongside other organisations in challenging attitudes to learning disability and insisting that services meet their needs as much as they meet the needs of the mainstream community. And indeed, we know that this country witnessed a social revolution in the last generation, opening up the long-stay hospitals and ensuring that people were defined by their abilities and ability to achieve their potential rather than a presumption of what people couldn't do because they had a learning disability. That was a social revolution we should all celebrate. We should also recognise the importance of proper support for people in our communities to make sure that they can achieve that potential. I also want to congratulate Enable, particularly on this important report, drawing as it does directly on the experiences of young people with learning disabilities, showing the gap between the policy that we all endorse and the reality for too many young people. The idea that a youngster in school describes themselves as being lonely, unable to participate in trips and so on, must come as a reality check for us all, and it must give us pause. The presumption of mainstreaming was a hard fought for policy, and I remember it well as somebody in the Parliament in these very early days, fought for by parents who argued not just about the needs of their young people with learning disabilities and other disabilities, but the importance of that inclusive society for all of our young people, that all of us learn from ensuring that we live in an inclusive community. But it needs to be followed through. It's not always the case that mainstream education is the right thing for a young person. And we hear anecdotally of some families who will say that they believe the young person has been placed in mainstream, guaranteed that they will fail, and then move on to a specialist provision, which they're already damaged and they're already affected by that. So there needs to be proper assessment of the needs of young people. But also it's true that without proper support, there is a danger that the mainstream community turns on the child with a disability as if they are the one with the problem, that everything would be okay if it weren't for the fact that children with additional support needs were in the classroom. That is a real danger, and it must be resisted at all costs, because as I've said, an inclusive education benefits all young people. And I would recommend to people, as has already been said, to look at the evidence taken by the Education Committee on the challenges facing young people with additional support needs, a provision for them. This is not an added extra. Additional support need is central to ensuring that people achieve their potential in school and in education. And it's not something that can be just explained away or wished away. It is in the fabric of our education system. And if it's not happening, then it needs to be challenged. And the reality is that budgets must follow the policy. It's not enough that we say we care about this. We must ensure that the budgets then follow that process. And I would say, and I would ask the Minister to respond to this point, that there is a consequence of targeting cuts on local authorities. The cuts to their budgets, we know from the evidence we have taken, hasn't meant a reduction in the amount of classroom support, the additional support that a school needs to make sure that all young people achieve their potential. So in conclusion, I say I welcome the report. I think it's a challenge for us all, and I would look in the Minister's response to a commitment from the Scottish Government to respond in detail to the recommendations of the ENABLE report, because I think they give a very important direction to the work we should be doing over the next period.
Call Alexander Burnett to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also echo the Chamber and congratulate Graeme Dey on bringing forward this motion to Parliament. It is also important we note the great work already going on throughout our schools by teachers. We must recognise that this is a debate based around how the Scottish Government must support our teachers and allow our teachers to deliver the best inclusive education to everyone. Now, I also welcome the aims of ENABLE Scotland and its wish to deliver inclusive education. Their 22-step journey is admirable, and I support its aims full-heartedly. Now, there have been many good points raised in this debate already, which, whilst I agree with them, I am keen not to spend time repeating. And however, it is simply not good enough that 80% of the education workforce think we are not getting it right for every child. And I would like to look at how we can fix these statistics and stop failing children who are less fortunate than our own. I think it is helpful when faced with such statistics to look around and see where others have got it right and how we might replicate this. Now, it's always difficult in a debate with such consensus not to be repetitive, but I hope you'll be happy to follow me outside of a classroom now. In the Cairngorms National Park, in my constituency, we've managed successfully to integrate additional needs groups into the park, and I feel this is something we should all be able to learn from. The National Park has some of the most rigid terrain in Britain, and that would usually mean no access to those in wheelchairs or unable to walk, and further exclusion to those already disadvantaged. However, this is not the case. Over the last 10 years, the Cairngorms National Park have invested £7.5 million to improve pathways across the park for less fortunate. This includes 666 miles of designated core paths that are made fit for purpose for all. And the park also offers a travel grant to underrepresented groups. These were fully subscribed in 2015 and 2016 and given to 28 schools and 15 voluntary groups. In addition, the park runs the Backbone Project, which engages over 2,500 people from marginalised groups through community engagement initiatives, including a Festival for All, which will take place on the Athol Estate on the 24th of September for any MSPs interested in attending. Now, all these great projects are part of a much larger Cairngorms Equality Action Plan, in which specific targets are made for inclusion in each section of the park. This results in a space where additional needs children not only feel welcome, but able to participate just like everyone else, a place where they can interact and make friends. So we must find a way to transfer the results of a national park into our schools. Unfortunately, the mountains we must climb aren't in the Cairngorms, but in our schools. Thank you.
The last of the open speeches is Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, let me join with others in thanking Graeme Dey for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And of course, let me pay tribute to ENABLE Scotland for their report included in the main, together with all the work they do to advance the rights of people with learning disabilities. As many in the Chamber may know, I am proud to convene the Cross-Party Group on Learning Disabilities in the Parliament. Some of them, the members, are indeed in the Chamber this evening, because in fact we had a cross-party group meeting this lunchtime and, surprise, surprise, talked about the issues thrown up by the report. The report is a national conversation about life at school. There is no doubt that education has improved considerably, But you know, the interesting thing was that it's been 17 years since the presumption to mainstream young people with learning disabilities in education. So we've seen a whole generation go through every stage of education, and this report, reflecting as it does on their lived experience, their parents, their carers, and their teachers' experience, is just so valuable. But what their stories and experience tell us is that there is much more to do. For too many young people in our country, inclusive education is still not a reality. Many are still being excluded from classrooms and from opportunities that would enrich their everyday lives. Enable Scotland's report sets out, as other members have covered, 22 steps we can take to make inclusion in education the standard for all of Scotland's young people. But I want to focus on a couple of areas. The need for specialist staff was touched on by Daniel Johnson, because the research undertaken shows us that 98% of teachers feel that they're not adequately prepared. 86% of classroom teachers said that there isn't enough additional support for learning staff in their schools to support those young people with learning disabilities. And as we've heard from other members, 80% of education staff saying that we're not getting it right for every child. And I don't say this, Graeme Dey, to score party political points, but there are cuts to education budgets, and that's having an impact, because I've had many cases of parents and teachers complaining about the lack of support in the classroom that has an impact on their children. So I would urge the Scottish Government to consider all of the recommendations, and particularly the education workforce ones, make that central to work going forward. I note Enable Scotland's call for renewed investment in the role of additional support for learning teachers, and I hope that that will be supported, because that would ensure that that specialist resource is regularly available to all education staff. Can I welcome John Swinney's commitment to guidance on inclusive education? I think that's critically important. I want inclusive education embedded into every part of the curriculum, and I want us to ensure that the specialist teaching resource is in place to support that too. Training and employment for specialist support teachers matters. Additionally, this will benefit not only the pupils who rely on this kind of support at school, but the teachers and education staff who are routinely put under pressure at work, many of them feeling stressed and anxious due to not having that right support to meet the needs of children and young people with learning disabilities. The need for additional support for learning teachers was highlighted by people in my own constituency as part of Enable Scotland's national conversation. And I want to draw attention to two particular responses, one from a parent in Western Bartonshire, the other from a teacher in Argyll and Bute. Both stated that they didn't believe that proper support for children and young people with learning disabilities was actually in place. And in Argyll and Bute, the teacher highlighted that all of the training for additional support needs had been organised by them privately, and that the local authority had provided no support whatsoever. That clearly isn't good enough. We can do better, we must do better, we owe it to future generations of young people with learning disabilities to make it better. A good start would be for the government to implement the recommendations in the report. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I now call Shirley-Ann Somerville to close this debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by also thanking Graeme Dey for bringing this debate and for all the members for their contribution. The ethos of Scottish education, as many members have touched upon, is an inclusive one. Inclusion is the cornerstone to help us achieve excellence and equity in education for all of our children and young people. Now, Scotland has one of the most inclusive systems for the provision of support in schools across Europe. We're proud of that approach, and as Mr. Dey's motion has noted, we firmly reject the idea that any child is unable to be educated. And as Jeremy Balfour touched upon, when Enable Scotland was founded 62 years ago, those with learning disabilities did not have an equitable, inclusive experience in education. In fact, it was a challenge to receive any education at all. Now, 95% of Scotland's children and young people who have an additional support need are educated in a mainstream school. While being ambitious for the future, it's important to recognise just how far we have come. The introduction of the presumption of mainstreaming in 2000 gave all children and young people in Scotland the opportunity to be present in a mainstream school. But it's now important that we build on that to ensure that those with additional support needs are more than just present, but they're also participating and achieving as part of the school community. Our educationalists strive to overcome barriers to learning for all and to ensure Scotland's children and young people can achieve their full potential. The most recent statistics indicate that there is an improving picture in the qualifications and destinations of children and young people with additional support needs. However, despite the progress that has been made, the government is aware that there is much room for improvement. So Enable Scotland's report included in the main has been an invaluable source of information on the experience of educationalists, parents and carers, and perhaps most importantly, the children and young people themselves. The Scottish Government works closely with Enable Scotland. Jan Savage, for example, from Enable Scotland chairs our advisory group on additional support for learning. And Enable are also members of the Disabled Children and Young People's Advisory Group. They are committed advocates for all with learning disabilities in Scotland. And I am clear, and the Cabinet Secretary is clear, that where pupils can learn in a mainstream school, they should do so. However, our law on mainstreaming has clear expectations to enable children and young people to learn in the education provision that best suits their needs. This is in accordance with the duty of education authorities to provide for the needs of each child under the Additional Support for Learning Act. It also relates to our wider policy of getting it right for every child and ensuring we tailor our approach to help each and every child reach their full potential. Now, the presumption of mainstreaming has ensured that all children and young people have the right to be present, as I mentioned earlier. The challenge is to ensure that they participate and achieve in all aspects of school life, an aspect which Jeremy Balfour spoke very powerfully about earlier on. Now, in this, in some ways, we are starting from a position of strength. Legislatively, we have enshrined the rights of children and young people, ensuring that they are entitled to receive the support that they need to succeed. In policy, we have placed the needs of each and every child and young person at the heart of our approach, leading to a commitment to get it right for every child. In curriculum for excellence, we have a flexible, adaptive curriculum which allows the needs of every child and young person to be catered for. And to help headteachers consider how to close the attainment gap in the wider context of disadvantage, we are currently finalising the national operational guidance which will support headteachers to implement the Pupil Equity Fund, which I hope addresses the point that Graeme Dey made in his opening remarks. Because what we now need is clarity on our vision for inclusion and how this vision can be implemented. On 19th May, we will be launching a public consultation on fresh guidance on the presumption of mainstreaming. This guidance will assist educationalists when making difficult decisions about provision and will empower parents to know their rights and the rights of their child in placement decisions. It will set out our vision for inclusion in Scotland's schools, emboldening all actors in our education system to be ambitious for each and every child and young person in Scotland. Some aspects of this discussion will be difficult. As we can see in the Enable report, we aren't discussing abstract concepts. We're working to improve the well-being and the future of individual children and young people, their families and those who are providing the education. This is an emotional debate, and rightly so, because there is surely nothing more important than the start we give to our children and young people. And one major theme of the Enable report is that of visibility and accountability, especially as regards how we accept and value difference, how we appreciate and support those who face barriers to learning. This isn't just a system issue or a resource issue, but a challenge for each and every one of us to examine and challenge our attitudes towards those with additional support needs.
Certainly. Joanne Lamont.
I absolutely agree with you. It's not just a budget issue and it's not just a resource issue. It is about attitudes, and that's why it's been such a powerful campaign over many years to secure mainstream education and inclusive education. But would you accept that resources do matter? And the evidence to the Education Committee is that we're losing the classroom support, the personal support, the things that make a difference to people accessing opportunities in education.
Shirley-Ann Somerville.
I don't disagree with Joanne Lamont that resources are not an issue. But I think what we do need to recognise is, while the Scottish Government will look very clearly at the Enable report and its recommendations, I hope every single council does as well, because we all have to be responsible for our budgeted decisions. That's the Scottish Government and also every council that takes those budgetary decisions on staffing within the education system. We also need to remember, and we certainly shouldn't be content, that we should expect any less for our children and young people with additional support needs. And that's why accepting and appreciating difference is a very crucial lesson for us all to learn, and it's one that we hope our children and young people are now learning in our inclusive education system. Just as all of us in this chamber are different and stronger for it, so too are our children and our young people. Our diversity is our strength, and growing together, learning together, working together will help us build a more just society. And David Torrance put this very well, talking about communities being built within our schools. Joanne Lamont made that same point too. This debate has been an important opportunity to reflect once again on how we ensure excellence and equity for all our children and young people in Scotland. The voice of the children and young people will be our best guide as we take this work forward. The most important thing for the Scottish Government to do in this context is to listen. We will listen to the comments made by the respondents in the ENABLE report, and we will carefully consider each recommendation made by ENABLE. But we will also not be afraid to champion the progress that we have achieved, to use it as an inspiration for improvement where we need to do that. The Scottish Government will be tireless advocates for all of the Scotland's children and young people, and working alongside partners like ENABLE, we will continue to strive for the best possible future for each and every child and young person in Scotland. And finally, Presiding Officer, can I end, as others have already done during this debate, by paying tribute to the teachers, the learning support teachers and support staff who play such a valuable and integral role day in, day out in every school across Scotland.
This meeting is closed.